Morning, good morning. And now it's Friday. You know, the week has gone so fast. Welcome to The Mint. I'm Andy Hodges. Today's stories: Zimbabwe slashes its manufacturing sector growth projections to 1% for 2019. And do you want to know what Jacob Zuma said in front of the State Capture Commission? Don't go away. All this and more on The Mint. We'll be right back. Now, of course, we always start, as usual, on The Mint at the Zimbabwe Stock Exchange. And, of course, as we've said over the last week or so, you can see that there's very little trading going on there. The market is seeking direction. You can see that the all-share index is up marginally, 0.06%, as is the industrial index. Really not a lot of trades going on yesterday. Top 10 also gained 0.13%, and of course mining is flat. However, the big story for yesterday, of course, there's actually two big stories, I lie. First story, of course, is the looking at the biggest loser. British American Tobacco was down almost $3.50 on the day. Again, I think it's just more profit taking. I don't think really there's any loss in the stock. In fact, looking at market analysts, they think the Zimbabwe Stock Exchange is undervalued. But of course, the major news coming out this week is, who is buying CBZ Holdings? Somebody has snapped up almost 20% of CBZ Holdings, the mystery buyer. We're going to try and find out who that is. I think everybody in the market is trying to try and find out who that is. But that really is what's happening in the stock market. Other stocks that traded down or very slightly lower, you saw that 0.06%. Nothing's really happening in the stock market at the moment. But the stocks that traded down, stocks like PPC, Meikle's Africa was slightly lower, 0.01 cents. Old Mutual Limited also was down. But then again, the Old Mutual has been up and down over the course of the week by marginal amounts. And of course, Econet down very slightly as well. And in fact, the only counter that traded in the positive yesterday was Cassava Smart Tech, which was also up very marginally. So really, the Zimbabwe Stock Exchange is just treading water. Now then, there's excitement in South Africa because State Capture Commission is now in place. And of course, from Monday, ex-president Jacob Zuma testified before it. He appeared before it on Monday. The commission is headed by Deputy Chief Justice Zondo, and he was asked to respond to allegations of corruption leveled against him, State Capture, and his relationship with the Gupta family in South Africa. However, Jacob Zuma, in a surprise move, called a halt to the proceedings because he believed that the questions coming in, he cried foul. In fact, his legal team said the kind of questions he was being asked weren't appropriate. In fact, Zuma complained of unfair interrogation as he was quizzed over the appointment of a high-ranking official he allegedly imposed on a state-owned company. Zuma's testimony hopefully will resume this morning if an agreement is reached between the commission and his legal team. But look, let's have a look at some of the takeaways from his testimony. Let's see what he actually said. He said, I was offered to resign. Zuma said, I was told to resign, go to Nkandla, and I will be looked after. Just resign, he said he was told. And in Nkandla Homestead, he said, there were two structures of that government investigated. They found nothing on Zuma, and so I have been vilified in the world for no reason. And of course, on State Capture, he says, you know what? This isn't State Capture. For me, this is just simple corruption. And no Gupta appointments. You know, the allegation was that the Guptas influenced him to appoint various ministers, particularly one time the Minister of Finance. Zuma said, there was no such thing. I am still waiting for somebody who will say, yes, you appointed this one in this way or that way. Anyway, and of course, Zuma said he was provoked. He said, I've been provoked to the last degree at times by people who I knew what they were doing. So it appears that President Jacob Zuma, ex-President Zuma, is trying to throw the spotlight onto shenanigans, not just of other people in government at the time, but also of the ANC government. In fact, one of his explosive comments was he accused one of the top members of the ANC of being a spy in the 1990s. So, of course, we're going to have much more political spill coming out of that State Capture Commission, and we're going to keep an eye on it for you because it does affect the economic and the balance of power, if I can call it that, the ANC's economic power. If they're wrapped up in the State Capture Commission, obviously they're not focusing on what's important, which is turning around the South African economy. Now then, let's look at U.S. stocks. Now, U.S. stocks fell for the third day in a row as investors were concerned about the latest batch of quarterly corporate reports. The big mover yesterday was Netflix. Netflix shares plunged more than 10% after the streaming giant reported a surprise loss in the Europe subsidiaries, coupled with slower than expected international membership growth. These metrics are key for Netflix. They offset a better than expected earnings per share result for the previous quarter. Of course, Netflix is a subscriber-based company. So if they report a reduced subscriber base, that obviously implies reduced profits. Now, the stock's drop dragged the Invesco Triple Q Trust ETF down 0.04%. IBM shares, again, IBM are not doing so well. They reported their fourth consecutive decline in revenues for the quarter. Declining sales from IBM's IT division offset growth in its cloud business. Do you remember the day when IBM was the only player in town? And in fact, late news we got last night is its chief rival, well, not anymore, of course, but Microsoft actually produced record profits. We're going to report on that on Monday, and we're going to have a look at some of the numbers of Microsoft. But Microsoft seems to be on a bit of a rebound at the moment. Of course, Bill Gates is now the third richest man in the world, only worth a measly $102 billion. Anyway, so far, 12% of the S&P 500 companies have reported quarterly results this earnings season. Of those companies, nearly 84% have reported better than expected earning revenues. However, the market still thinks that corporate earnings will be down about 3% across the board. But there's still a lot of companies to report, so we're going to keep an eye on that for you here on The Mint. Please don't forget to keep your comments coming in our Facebook page, Zim Papers TV Network, and of course, our website, ztn.co.zw. We want to hear from you. Now then, looking at European stocks. European stocks traded lower yesterday as investors digest fresh corporate results. Again, corporate earning results are also happening in Europe, and also keeping an eye on global trade developments. There it is. I can't go a day without mentioning the US-China trade developments. Anyway, it's there and it's affecting the global world. Now, investors are watching numbers from latest earnings season, with a slew of companies reporting their results this week. S&P stock fell 5.6% after Europe's most valuable tech company quarterly revenue and adjusted operating profit came in below expectations, dragging down tech stocks throughout the continent. And Novartis beat analyst expectations for the second quarter, reporting strong results and raising its guidance for the year, leading its shares 4.7% higher during the session. Now then, Danske Bank's second quarter pre-tax profit came in below expectations on Thursday, hit by low interest rates and higher costs associated with compliance in the aftermath of a huge money laundering scheme in its branch in Estonia. Its shares traded just above the flat line during the day. However, there is pressure on banking stocks in the UK, in Eurozone. Swedish engineering company Indutrade plummeted 12.5% to the bottom of the European blue chip index after its earnings report, while French gaming company Ubisoft climbed 3.8% after reporting upbeat first quarter sales. And ASOS shares slumped 15%. The British online fashion retailer issued its third profit warning in 8 months. Problem in fashion, problem in retail stores in the UK as people are moving more to online shopping and online, particularly Amazon. That's what Amazon is doing so well. But retailers are having a huge time. High street shops are having a huge time. And in fact, they're scaling back their operations all through Europe, particularly in the UK and the high streets. Also on the focus, of course, in Europe is a US-China trade spat, if I can call it that. The Wall Street Journal reported Wednesday that trade negotiations between the world's two largest economies are at an impasse over restrictions on Chinese giant Huawei. Anyway, that's it for European markets. Now, let's look at Asia. Now, stocks in Japan were the biggest losers amongst the major markets in the region on Thursday, with the other Asian bourses following suit amid a renewed threat to trade. The Nikkei 225 dropped 1.97% to close at around 21,046. This is actually where it's trading right now. And shares of heavyweight SoftBank Group and Fanuc declined 2.41% and 1.97% respectively. You can see that mainland China, we saw losses as well on the day. Shanghai Composite was declined 1.4% on the day, and the Shenzhen component was down 1.58%. Hong Kong's Hang Seng Index also declined in the final hours, with Chinese shares of their giant Tencent dropping 1.49%. Again, also down in South Korea. That also was down 0.31% on the day. But of course, the Bank of Korea yesterday announced that it's cutting its base rate by 25 basis points to 1.5% following a cut to South Korea's growth rate. Really, this is all about an ongoing war between, I call it a war, it's a trade war, between Japan and South Korea. That has seen Japan place import curbs on important materials used by South Korea's technology sector. It's a dispute over something that happened way back in World War II, but these things are fresh in people's minds, and obviously they need to deal with this so that they can get back to normal trade. Apple supplier and the world's largest contract chip maker, Taiwan Semiconductor Manufacturing Company, said on Thursday it posted a 7.6% fall in second quarter net profits. It said its April to June profit was $2.15 billion. And in Australia jobs data released on Thursday showed the country's unemployment rate remains at 5.2% in June. Listen to this number. A net 500 new jobs were created in the month, far off the expected 10,000 figure that analysts had predicted. Now then, let's have a quick look at African currencies. I think the only good news there, of course, is the interbank rate and the street market rate appear to be stable at the moment, if not even diverging towards each other. That's great news for the economy here in Zimbabwe. Now then, looking at US dollar prices, US dollar slipped again on Thursday. Risk aversion in the broader markets pushed benchmark US Treasury yields to a 9-day low. The dollar index versus a basket of six major currencies was down 0.2% on the day. But you know what? It edged lower as the safe haven Treasury yields fell in the wake of weak U.S. housing market data and concerns again about the prolonged U.S.-China trade dispute. Various economic data has given conflicting stories about the strength or the state of the U.S. economy. But that doesn't change the bigger picture of the dollar facing downward pressure due to an unexpected rate cut by the Federal Reserve Bank. Sorry, an expected rate cut by the Federal Reserve Bank at the end of this month. In fact, the markets have already factored in a 25 basis point rate cut. If the Fed goes higher than that, if they go a 50 basis point rate cut, we can expect to see some weakness in the dollar even further. However, it will be good for the U.S. economy. The IMF believes that the dollar, unfortunately, is overvalued by 6 to 12%. Based on near-term economic fundamentals. If those numbers are right, we should see a dollar correction in the very short term. And coupled with an interest rate cut by the Federal Reserve Bank sometime next week, we should obviously see weakness in the dollar, which will obviously strengthen other currencies around the world. Now then, sterling was also a little bit higher yesterday at 124.38. It has stumbled to 1.2382, its lowest since April 2017 on Wednesday, amid growing risks of Britain leaving the European Union and no Brexit deal. That's the biggest fear. In fact, yesterday the Parliament in England actually smuggled through some form of legislation to ensure that the government cannot suspend Parliament and actually then pull out of Brexit without Parliament having a say. We're going to keep an eye on this, of course, because Brexit, no Brexit, what's going to happen? That's critical to the economy in Europe. Now then, let's have a quick look at commodities, metals and energy prices. The only really thing I want to point out, particularly when it comes to the metals and energy sectors, the oil market, oil volatility, it's Middle East worries have really pushed the price of oil, particularly with the condition between Iran and the rest of the world and the sanctions and seizing of tankers. But we're going to keep an eye on that for you. Now then, that's it for In the Market. Now, coming up after the break, Zimbabwe slashes its manufacturing sector growth to 1% for 2019. And Rainbow Tourism Group, RTG, they're looking at expanding in South Africa, in Victoria Falls. The tourism sector in Zimbabwe is booming. So why not? All this and more after the breather. You know, it's Friday, and of course, like we always try and do on The Mint, we try and give you at least something amusing, but amusing in a business sense. Now, this is actually what I would like to highlight to you, is that entrepreneurs or people that see great ideas, they look at something in a different way. So there's a great story of where people are standing in the rain and some of them have got umbrellas. And if you look at that, there's it there. Look, one sees rain to be avoided. That's the people on the left. But look at the entrepreneur. He sees it to be harvested. Entrepreneurship is a mindset. So if that can be anything for our message for you on a Friday, you budding entrepreneurs out there, it's a mindset. Always look for opportunities because that's where you'll find them. Remember we did this story yesterday about a guy who's a millionaire now because he invented a plastic wishbone. Ideas are everywhere. You just have to know where to find them and then how to make your dreams come true. Now then, our main story today. Zimbabwe has slashed its manufacturing sector growth projection for 2019 to 1% from initial budget provision projection of 2.5%. Industry and Commerce Minister Mangoliso Ndlovu attributed the new projection to foreign exchange shortages and other macroeconomic challenges. Similarly, the minister also pointed out that while Zimbabwe's National Industrial Policy, SNIDP, envisages that the country should attain 80% capacity utilization by 2023. Capacity utilization for 2019 was projected at a mere 34%. Now, why is this important? Well, manufacturing is critical because we always say that one thing Zimbabwe needs to do is produce. We need to produce products, not just for our local domestic market, but also to export into the region. And coming on of the African Free Trade Continental Agreement, it's critical that we also can access African markets where we do minimal trade at the moment. So this industrial policy announced by the Ministry of Industry and Commerce was critical in the terms of giving industry guidance on which way we are going to be going in terms of manufacturing. One of the major issues, of course, there is retooling. However, the minister, very, very wisely, I must say, has come out and reduced his projections. Our Mint correspondent in Dhaka Majaka has more on this issue.
Zimbabwe has slashed its manufacturing sector growth projection for 2019 to 1% from 2.5%. The sector, which has shown positive growth since Zimbabwe adopted the multi-currency regime in 2009, hit a low of minus 5 in 2014. At its peak, the manufacturing sector recorded a high of 13.8%. Despite a maiden industrial policy document which forecasts an 85% capacity utilization by 2023, this year's capacity utilization is seen at a paltry 34%. Zimbabwe's manufacturing industry has been failing to produce to optimum levels, contributing to a huge trade deficit, with the country currently importing most of its consumptive products. To counter this, government has come up with a local content policy to stimulate local production. For The Mint, I'm Dhaka Majaka in Harare.
Now let's have a look at some of those numbers. I mean, in 2009, manufacturing sector grew 10.2%. And it dipped to 2.5% in 2010, but still a growth. And then, of course, a high of 13.8% in 2013. 2014, it contracted to by minus 5% before gaining some momentum in 2018 to 1.3%. And, of course, now the minister's forecasting 1%. But I think one critical area of the policy that was announced by the Ministry of Industry and Commerce is local content substitution. It's important that we start moving away from imported products and start producing local content products so that we can harness our huge potential in our country rather than use imported products. And this is what we're doing, almost $5 billion worth year on year. It's too much, we've got to reduce it. Now then, Kenya. Kenya has partnered with Djibouti to construct Kenya's first fifth submarine cable at a cost of $59 million. The director of shared services at the ICT authority, Robert Mugo, confirmed the reports and said the project, dubbed the Djibouti Africa Regional Express, or DARE, is aimed at powering an inclusive digital economy. The DARE is set to run from Djibouti to Mombasa and will act as a complement to the current subsea optical fibers, SEACOM. That's from East African Marine Cable System, Eastern African Submarine Cable System, EC, and Lion 2 that links Madagascar to Kenya. Now, one of the cables will run, listen to this, from Pakistan all the way across in Asia to Mombasa, then through the Suez Canal to Egypt and Europe. According to Kenya's Digital Economic Blueprint, it is estimated that the digital economy will be worth $23 trillion by 2025, and that returns on ICT investments will be 6.7 times higher than in other investment sector. Are you listening out there? ICT is a growth sector in the future. And in fact, I understand the ICT policy that's coming out. One day we're going to have a look at it to see how is Zimbabwe positioned for growth in the ICT sector. The 2019 Kenyan National Economic Survey report showed the value of the ICT sector expanded by 12.9% from $3 trillion in 2017 to $4 trillion in 2018, driven by the growth in the digital economy. Now then, some of the most Napsters. Napsters is some of its most valuable holdings, including its shares in Tencent. Napsters is South Africa's largest company, and in fact, one of the world's largest companies. They're going to be moving to set up a new holding company in Europe. The assets will be available on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange via a secondary listing. Napsters announces creating a new company that will hold all its overseas internet companies. This includes a 31% stake in the Chinese giant Tencent, as well as its stakes in many other digital companies, including the Indian online food delivery service Swiggy and Indian online travel site Make My Trip. Also included will be the global online selling platform OLX, as well as the biggest online classifieds and property platform in Russia, Avito, and Russia's biggest internet company with large gaming, social media, and e-commerce business called Mail.ru. Napsters expects the new group will be Europe's largest listed global consumer internet company, measured by asset value. The products and services that will be offered or owned by the new company are used by about a fifth of the world's population. The new company is still to be named, but for now will be known as NewCo, new company. We'll have a primary listing on the Amsterdam Bourse, but local investors will be able to buy it via a secondary listing on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange. Now the question is, why have Napsters done this? Well, listen to this and you'll be really shocked. Napsters shares are trading far below what its assets are worth. Let's take an example. Its stake in the company Tencent Holdings alone is worth 1.9 trillion rand. But if you look at the value of Napsters on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange, it's only valued at 1.43 trillion rand. So there's a huge gap there. That effectively means that investors in Napsters are getting its other assets, including its Russian and Indian companies, pretty much for free. In fact, depending on how you value those businesses, it appears Napsters is undervalued by between 20 and 40%. Another reason, of course, is that if they list in the European markets on the Amsterdam Bourse, other global hedge funds and global investors will be able to access the stock restrictions that are there at the moment in investing in the stock on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange. The Naspers will hold 75% of the NewCo, as well as Media24 and the online retailer TakeALot.com. In fact, Naspers shares represent a fifth of the trading that's happening, or a fifth of the value on the Johannesburg Stock Exchange. Now then, tourism. One area of our economy in Zimbabwe that is booming is tourism. In fact, tourism growth has gone up year on year with as much as 2.5 million arrivals last year. And one of our largest hospitality groups, Rainbow Tourism Group, is also looking at taking advantage of that expansion. It said it's moving to expand its Victoria Falls portfolio and add rooms to its existing property in the resort town. The firm says it is cashing in on the tourism boom. As I said, that's all international tourism arrivals hitting 2.5 million. Mint correspondent in Dhaka, Majaka, gives us more.
$2.2 million in product upgrades. Its foreign revenues have grown to 11 million from 8.9 million prior year. Going forward, RTG says it will pursue an asset-light growth model. For the Mint, I'm Dhaka Majaka in Harare.
Yeah, well, sorry about that, but unfortunately, the fact is this, is that RTG, as I said, sees huge potential. In fact, one of the tips we've given you here on the Mint is to make sure that you look at tourism stocks. There's no doubt that tourism stocks seem to be a huge growth area because if you think about it, it makes sense. A lot of the tourist resort areas are out of, say, the city centers. They're not in Harare, they're not in Bulawayo, even though, of course, there are beautiful things in those cities to see for tourists. There are things like Great Zimbabwe, Victoria Falls, Kariba, Matopos, you know, areas where people can, Chinoy Caves, let me not forget that, one of my most beautiful areas in the country. So a lot of the tourism sector is not affected necessarily by what's happening in the generality of Zimbabwe. So the fact is this, is that tourism is a growth sector. We must continue to market our tourism sector, and RTG being one of the top hospitality groups in the country and a stock that I would recommend that you look at as an investor, particularly for long-term investment returns, is making sure that they take advantage of what's happening. And take my hats off to them. Some of the properties they own are some of the best in the country, and I'm sure all of you at some point have stayed at an RTG hotel or lodge. Anyway, now then, of course, unfortunately, you know, we always get to a point in the show where we always come to the end, and I feel really sad because after a week of being here with you, I just want to keep on going. But anyway, as we know, our final story. Most successful entrepreneurs make their money building popular websites. It appears to be the big thing today. People are moving into e-commerce. They're moving into website design, game design, and so on. But not a guy called Fraser Doherty. He built his empire in a more traditional way. And I like this story because it highlights how you can do business or you can make business without being fancy, without having these huge college degrees or having skills in computer coding and so on and so forth. Well, Fraser started making jam at the age of 14. And where did he get the jam from? Well, he used his grandmother's recipes. And he started making the jam in his parents' kitchen in Scotland. And by 16, he had left school to work in his jam business full time. And his company was called Super Jam. Well, duh, Super Jam, it makes sense. So he worked there full time. Super Jam now sells around 500,000 jars of jam a year in most of the top supermarkets chains in UK and actually going out into Europe. And it currently controls 10% of the UK jam market. And Fraser Doherty's stake in the company, a cool $1 to $2 million. It just shows you again that good ideas can happen anywhere, and it's really critical that you keep your eyes open to what's going on around you, an entrepreneur as well. Unfortunately, that takes me to the end of the Mint for today, but we'd like to hear from you, please. You know, we're getting all your comments through the course of the weeks that we've been online now. You can get hold of us on our Facebook page, Zim Papers TV Network, and of course through our website, ztn.co.zw. Now, I also urge you, please, go and have a look at our ztn.co.zw. We have other reports coming from our newsroom here at ZTN. We've also got The Couch. We've also got Heartbeat. And there's a lot of other programming that's going on there that you would find exciting and keep you up to date with what's happening on a daily basis. So please, please follow our website, ztn.co.zw, and of course, our Facebook page, Zim Papers TV Network. Well, that's it. Another week gone, and I'm feeling kind of sad. But you know what's going to happen? I'm going to be happy again on Monday morning, because Monday morning, I'll be back right here, live from ZTN Studios in Harare, Zimbabwe, with The Mint, 10 a.m. on Monday. You have a great weekend, but one more thing. Be careful this weekend. And of course, I don't know what to say, but maybe Caption Island is going to be dynamos this weekend. Hey, I better go now. My name's Andy Hodges. Have a great weekend. Thank you.